Alright, hey everybody, this is Cups bringing another Monster Hunter World Iceborne video, and today we're going to be talking about the Charge Blade. Now this is the much asked for Charge Blade guide, since I made that last one in Base World that did pretty well. A lot of people have been asking me to update that guide in some sort of Iceborne fashion, especially on stream and in some of the previous YouTube videos. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Cups. I'm a Charge Blade main, but I play all 14 weapons. I stream on Twitch and I also make videos on YouTube now. So what is the Charge Blade exactly? The Charge Blade is a bit of a jack of all trades weapon. It's a bit cumbersome to pick up, I guess. It kind of intimidates people with some of the level of difficulty. There's a lot of mechanics going on at the same time. You need to know file charging and shield charging and savage axe and what level of guard do I need, my sword charge, how much do I tenderize, and do I use elemental or artillery and stuff like that. So I'm going to try to break that down as easily as I can for you so that it's not as intimidating as it was before. Okay, so what are some of the pros of the weapon? As I mentioned before, a tremendous amount of burst damage on the weapon. Guard points are really rewarding to learn. I guess since its introduction in 4U, Charge Blade is a bit kind of seen as like a veteran type weapon. There's a lot of things going on at the same time. And once you master all these mechanics, there's kind of no real feeling like it. Now, in Monster Hunter, all the weapons, the more you learn them, the more rewarding it becomes to play. But it seems like there's something kind of special about Charge Blade whenever you're transitioning from offense to defense and you're putting in a lot of plays. Now, some of the cons are Iceborne has not really been very nice to Charge Blade. There's been several nerfs, mainly the Super Amped Elemental Discharge motion value nerf. And also, if you get knocked out at SAED, you lose your files and you also stay in axe mode, which is pretty much a guaranteed death. And the introduction of tenderizing, it's just another timer that Charge Blade has to learn. So you have your shield charge, your sword charge, your savage axe charge, you have your tenderizer timing. There's a lot of stuff to maintain, but I still stand by the fact that it's a really rewarding and a lot of fun to play. But let's just hop right into it. And since, you know, I brought up the mechanics, I guess we'll just jump right into the mechanics and how the weapon works. So the main mechanic of Charge Blade, and if you want to look up there in the top left of your corner, there's three icons. Well, I guess there's multiple icons, but there's a sword, a shield, and then a bunch of little containers. Now, the containers are what's called files. Okay, so how you build file energy is you kind of just basically attack the monster. There are some attacks that Charge Blade has that kind of builds file energy, just kind of normal sword swings. As you can see, like these normal attacks kind of build some energy and things like that. But the main thing that you're going to want to hit is your charge circle attack or the charge double slash. That's the thing that's going to build the most energy for the weapon. Now there's three different file levels. There's white, there's yellow, and there's red. Yellow is going to give you, white is just nothing. Yellow is going to give you half the amount of files that you have, and red is going to fill your files up completely. And then so what you want to do, and the reason that you'd want to charge your files, is if you keep attacking the monster too much, your files will start to glow and put like this red aura around your sword, and that's going to make you start to dink. This is what's called overcharging, and this is really dangerous because in the real, you know, in the real back of attacking a monster, you're probably going to get hit and things like that, and it's going to really limit the amount of damage that you can do. So to alleviate this, you push R2 and circle to load those into your shield, and now you're free to start attacking again. And then so now that we have full files, exactly, you know, kind of what do I do next? What do I do with these files? Now what you want to do is dump those files into your shield, and I'll explain why you want to do that here in a little bit. But how you do it is you start the animation for the Super Amped Elemental Discharge, which we'll talk about again in a little bit. But you can just mash triangle, circle, triangle, circle, triangle, circle, and then push R2 to cancel it. And you'll see that the files get dumped into your shield. Now this does a couple different things. It just kind of automatically gives your shield a +2 block just by standing here. So this essentially just gives you guard 2. So if you have no levels of guard, you now have guard 2. So you'll see on a lot of Charge Blade sets, a lot of people run guard 1 on their sets. So now guard 1 plus guard 2, now they're sitting here at guard 3. Now guard pointing, which we'll talk about in a little bit, is going to give you guard 5 whenever you toss your guard points out. It's the first thing that you should do into a hunt is build files and then dump them into your shield, because it's going to make you take less stamina loss, less sharpness loss, less block damage and stuff like that. And it also opens up some of your more powerful abilities, like the Super Amped Elemental Discharge. Okay, so now that we have our shield charge, what do we do? So the next thing that you want to do typically is to charge your sword. Now charging your sword is kind of a circumstantial thing. You don't always want to do it, but whenever you have an opening in the battle, it'll give you a little extra damage and a little bit of extra utility. So how do I do that? The same mechanic that I did before, R2 and circle, and then I push triangle, and then whenever it locks into place, I let go of it. Now, as I mentioned before, this is going to give me a little bit of extra elemental damage. You see how my weapon is hitting twice. A little bit of extra elemental or impact damage depending on your file type, and it's also going to give you a natural mind's eye, which is going to let you just kind of cut right through things that you would normally dink against. So what this is really cool for, not a lot of people know about this, is whenever you have your sword charge and your shield charge and you have files, and you overcharge your files with your sword charge, you can actually get some extra damage and some cool combos where you do like standing swipe into shield pump, give you a ton of extra elemental damage, and you attack really quickly with it. So that's kind of a circumstantial thing. You don't really want to do that all that often, but just know that it's there. And then lastly, the newest thing that they added to Iceborne that people ask me about all the time is Savage Axe. So whenever you have files loaded, basically you want to do the same thing, is throw out like a super amped elemental discharge animation, but then push L2 instead of R2, and your hunter will kind of slide it along their back, and now you have Savage Axe out. So what does this do? This basically just gives your axe hits multiple hits along the way, and it adds more elemental damage or more impact, depending on your file type again. But basically just kind of lets you rip through monsters and do a ton of damage like that. It kind of acts like a dual blades at this point, because you're doing so many small hits and things like that. But very, very nice, and I'd say that this is kind of one of the stronger ways to play the weapon right now, and I'll explain in a little bit of what situation want to use Savage Axe as compared to SAED. Also, some new things that they added with Iceborne are Slinger mechanics. Slinger is a huge part of Iceborne, and there's a couple cool things that Charge Blade can do with Slinger. And the first thing that you can do is you can push L2 and R2, and you'll shoot it from there, which is really nice. So this is good for like flash pods and screamer pods. Let's say you're fighting a Diablos that digs under the ground. You could shoot a screamer pod and pull him out while still having your weapon out, which is really cool. And then also what you can do is, let's say you block into something, you can actually turn around with L2 and then continue your attack that way. So it's really nice for monsters that kind of charge through you, maybe like an Ebony of Odogaron that jumps over the top of you and you get a block off. You can slinger in the opposite direction and throw an AED or something like that at them. So I turn around and then I can throw an SAED at them, something like that. Pretty cool stuff. I'd say the most slinger intensive mechanic that I use is whenever I'm playing multiplayer and I'm using Savage Axe, because on some of your Savage Axe attacks, you're going to launch your teammate like this, and you don't really want to do that very often. And that's kind of part of the Savage Axe bread and butter combo. So what I like to do is I like to do the double circle combo like this and then shoot a slinger, so that I'm not launching my teammates. And this is also good if you have something like a piercing pod or something like that, and you need to flinch the monster to continue your attacking. Okay, so now you know how to charge your files, charge your shield, charge your sword, Savage Axe, what situations to use slingers. Let's go ahead and jump into how to use these all these mechanics in the proper kind of gameplay loop, and what kind of thinking you want to have as a Charge Blade player whenever you're using them. Okay, so now you know which mechanics you need to do. How do I start to build those mechanics and start to do them? So what I'm going to start off with is some kind of combo routes, I guess. There aren't really true combos in Monster Hunter just because you have different varying times of opening and things like that, but I guess we'll kind of give you some sort of combo routes and things that you want to start looking at as quickly as possible. Typically, let's say like I just join in the hunt and I don't have any charge or anything like that. The combo that you're going to want to practice the most and get used to doing a lot if you're running Focus 3 on your skill set, and how you do this is jump charge slash, charge slash, and then spinning slash. And this is going to take you from white to red in one full combo. Now that's really nice to do, but let's say that you're not like progressing forward at all or anything like that. You don't need to do the jump slash. You can just do a standing triangle into charge slash into spinning slash. Then now you're back at red again. Just get used to doing this one a lot, because this is your most reliable way to build up to red. Now let's say you're not running focus. Let's say you're doing some sort of niche set, or you just don't like focus, or you're doing some sort of Savage Axe set that sometimes they don't use focus and things like that. What you want to be doing instead is charge slash, shield pump, charge slash, and that'll also bring you up to red. Okay, now this is the moment that we've all been waiting for, right? This is the SAED and the AED, the Super Amped Elemental Discharge and the Amped Elemental Discharge. This is the kind of iconic Charge Blade move with the big wide swing, camera kind of zooms in a little bit, and you dump all your files into the ground. Now, there's two different types of file types that I've mentioned before, and there's impact, which kind of travels in a straight, narrow line like this, and then there's the elemental files that kind of travel in like a wide cone shape like that. So how you want to do this, there's a couple different ways to get to your super amped elemental discharge: standing triangle, triangle and circle, like that. You can also do something like a slide into a shield pump, into the super amped elemental discharge. You can do it out of a guard point. There's a bunch of different ways to get to the super amped elemental discharge. It's kind of a high risk, high reward maneuver. It's a ton of damage in a very quick amount of time, but it's very risky to do, and Iceborne hasn't been kind to it because of, like I said, if you get hit or knocked down out of the animation of the super amped elemental discharge, you're going to lose your files and you're going to stay in axe form. So whenever you stand up, you're not really going to be able to defend yourself. So sometimes you'll get two shot and die and things like that. So you want to really pick your places when you're throwing SAED in you know, it kind of like in the community, the charge blade gets seen as like an unga bunga weapon or kind of something that like cavemen do because you kind of just turn off your brain and throw SAEDs. But with the new changes, you don't really want to do that anymore. So be mindful of where you're throwing your SAEDs. And a safer option, instead of the SAEDs, the AED. And you do that by pushing back in triangle whenever you're in your super amped elemental discharge. This is a little bit quicker, it's a little bit safer, has really good part break value or flinch value, so if you think that you might get close to KOing a monster or flinching it or something like that, AED is a really good option to go as well. It's really rewarding also when the monster is kind of turning its head and you're able to snipe the head and kind of get a KO out of it and stuff like that. It takes a lot of mastery and a lot of knowledge to properly do AEDs, so I recommend that you practice them as often as you can. And AEDs also go really nicely with Savage Axe gameplay because you'll get multiple rips on the way down from top to bottom. Okay, so we've knocked the monster down with our SAED or our AED, and then how do we start our Savage Axing? So as I mentioned before, this is how you start up the Savage Axe. Go ahead and activate it, and your character will kind of take like a step back. So after this, you typically want to push towards and circle, and then circle, and then triangle, and then circle. Now just be careful, because whenever you push your triangle, this will launch your teammates and things like that. So go ahead and go back to that slinger combo that I talked to you about before, where you push L2 and do your slinger combos if you're doing it in multiplayer, so you're not launching your teammates away. And this does not get saved by flinch free, so if your teammates are slotting in flinch free, this will still launch them, so just don't do it in multiplayer. So typically what I do is whenever I'm doing like my triangle and circle, you know, kind of the loop that this is kind of like an infinite that goes on forever. But I typically try to time my AED. You can push it one more time and then get an AED. And this is kind of what I save for the monster as it's standing up. Now the Savage Axe, as long as you have files, it'll keep going. So you're going to need to switch back and forth with the weapon to maintain your Savage Axe. So this is why you typically don't want to throw SAEDs, because the second you throw an SAED, you lose your Savage Axe charge and you got to start all over again. So what I kind of like to do is do my Savage Axe combos, and I start getting low on files. So then I switch back over to shield mode by pushing R2, and then I can start building more energy and things like that. Now, after you've kind of built enough energy on sword and shield mode and you want to go back to Savage Axing, you push R2 and circle, and then circle again, and then your character will load those files and then go right back into Savage Axing. So you kind of want to do this when the monster's down and then go into sword and shield mode to protect yourself when you're back in neutral. Another good way of getting into Savage Axe is if you already have it activated, and let's say I'm running up to a downed monster here, you can push R2 and triangle, and then that'll start your morph slash, and then you can do your Savage Axe activation combos from here as well, so that's really nice. And that's probably the most reliable way to do it after you already have it, because this animation is kind of slow and your character also kind of steps back and, you know, it's kind of weird to use. So after you already have Savage Axe activation, just run up and do R2 and triangle, and you'll also get an attack from the way down. Okay, and the next thing we'll talk about are guard points. Guard points is kind of another iconic mechanic of Charge Blade that really takes a lot of monster knowledge and game knowledge and sensitivity for timing and a certain amount of bravery and sometimes a little bit of craziness to use properly. Now, as I mentioned before, guard pointing is kind of like a parry type maneuver that's going to increase the level of block that your sword and shield version has. And a lot of your moves, there's several moves that the Charge Blade has that the shield just kind of automatically goes in front of you without blocking. So see how the shield kind of goes in front of me there? That's what a guard point is. So there's certain transformation times or animations where the shield's going to go in front of your character, and then that's going to count as a guard point. So it's like a parry type maneuver that's going to give you big openings for things like SAEDing and side hopping and stuff like that, so you can kind of move around the monster. You'll also reflect a little bit of elemental damage or impact, depending on what files types you're using, back onto the monster. So let's say you're using an impact charge blade and the monster keeps running its head to your guard points over and over again. Eventually you're going to KO that monster or knock it out of the sky or something like that, and it just feels great. So get used to doing a lot of guard pointing, not just because it's really fun to do, but also because it's very, very useful. Whenever you're doing guard points, you're going to get an extra +2 to shield, like I mentioned before. So just with one level and a charge shield, you're going to get guard 5. So it's going to mean you're going to get less sharpness loss, less damage loss, less stamina loss, and things like that. And most importantly, there's different knockback versions to moves. You might notice that maybe like little Nergigante paw swipes, they might hit you, but they don't really do much to you. That's like a light knockback kind of move. And then there's also kind of things like shoulder checks that are more like medium knockback moves. And then there's large knockback moves, which are the gigantic hits that monsters do. So the higher your guard level is, the less knockback that you're going to get on that. So sometimes you'll get knocked back so far that you can't do an AED or an SAD. You just take the damage, you kind of recoil back, and then your character just stands back up. So we want to try to avoid that as much as possible. And guard pointing is a cheap and effective and really rewarding way of doing that. So get used to doing guard points as often as you can. Okay, and as we mentioned before, the SAD and the AED are also kind of like a three-step process where you got to do triangle, circle, triangle, and circle, triangle, and circle, or something like that. But what's really nice about guard pointing and blocking in general is that whenever you guard point or block a monster attack, you can go right into an SAED and skip all those steps. So it's going to open up a lot of opportunities to do a ton of damage for you. And then again, this time with files, I'll do some Savage Axe activation. Do this and then go into L2, and then you got a Savage Axe activation out of that as well. So it's very nice to do. You can also do things like whenever you're getting a guard point, you can do a side hop into side slash. And that's what I do probably 90% of the time, because some of the Iceborne monsters in Master Rank, they move really quickly and they attack and they recover really quickly and things like that. So you don't always have the opportunity to activate Savage Axe or do an SAD or something like that. So I'd say this is the one that I probably do the most whenever I guard point, side hop into side slash. All right, so now you know what a guard point is. Let's go ahead and go through what exactly are all the guard points. Now, there's a bunch of different ones. I might not catch them all, but I'm just going to make sure that I hit you with the most important ones, the things to look out for. And the one that you're going to want to practice the most is the R2 and triangle, that animation of me putting my sword into my shield. That's the guard point right there. And this is what you use whenever you're in sword and shield mode and you're running around and the monster's attacking and things like that. This is the one that you're going to be using the most. Say like probably 90% of the time this is the one that you're going to use. And a lot of your moves, the shield, like I mentioned before, kind of goes like right in front of you naturally, like this animation right there. Anytime you see that move right there, that one's kind of shared across a lot of the charge blade moves. Like whenever you do the slide back, basically the same animation. Whenever you do the side slash, basically the same animation. That's all a guard point on that. So make sure that you kind of keep an eye out for that whenever your character does the round slash and then puts the shield in front of them. That's also a guard point. That one's also quite useful as well. The sliding slash is kind of a bit more circumstantial. So the sliding slash guard point is a bit more circumstantial. So don't really get used to doing that for one for any more reason than just to kind of show off a little bit. But some of these other ones like this are very useful, and I find myself, you know, using them from time to time. But the main bread and butter is the R2 and triangle. Get used to doing that one. Iceborne adding new moves like Savage Axe means that Iceborne has also added a couple new guard points. And then whenever you go to do the Savage Axe activation, pushing L2, that's also a guard point where the shield kind of goes in front of your character's back. And I'll show it from the front here so you know what that looks like. See how the shield kind of goes across my back? That's another guard point. This one also I don't find myself using very often. It's kind of more if I'm just going to throw an amped elemental discharge or super amped and the monster kind of turns to attack me or something like that. I need to bail out so I don't get hit. So I'll start a super and be like, oh man, he's coming for me. And then I'll cancel into a Savage Axe. So that one, again, I don't find myself using that one besides really kind of flexing. Instead of bailing yourself out with a guard point, I'd probably recommend just knowing when your openings for SAD and AED are a little bit better. But again, if you're trying to flex and be cool, that one's a really, really good one. Now, in base world, you could get away with just running guard 1 on your sets. Guard 1 plus guard 2 plus guard 2 again would be guard 5. But Iceborne has brought some monsters that hit a lot harder and have greater knockback on their attacks. So you can't really get away with just running guard 1 anymore. A lot of monsters are going to want to run at least guard 3. And some monsters even want to run guard 5. And yes, even with a charge shield, guard 5, and a guard point, you're essentially giving yourself a guard 9. And that is how it works. It's not showing that because the game only goes up to guard 5. But it is kind of like a hidden value that's there. So things like you're going to want to run guard 5 against monsters like Ruiner Nergigante, Rajang, Safi Jiva, Brute Tigrex before you break his face. Once you break his face, his roars get weaker. So there's several monsters that you're going to want to use guard 5 plus a charge shield and a guard point against. I'd say that guard 1 is good for probably about 75% of the monsters in the game. Guard 3 is good for about 90% of the monsters. And then guard 5 is good for pretty much all the monsters. Pretty much on all my charge blade sets, regardless of its elemental or impact, I at least have two sets of one with guard 1 and one with guard 5. Now you're just going to need to know this through experience, because if you're not strong on guard pointing and things like that, you're probably just going to want to run guard 5 anyway. But if you're trying to greed and get as much damage and as much utility out of it, you need to kind of memorize monster knockbacks and what you should be guard pointing, what you should be getting out of the way of, so that you can, you know, slot in as much damage or utility as possible without having to devote so much to guard. And also with the iron side charm or whatever it is, you get a 5, and it's a pretty easy slot to, it's a pretty easy charm to just kind of throw on. Now, mobility options, Charge Blade kind of gets a lot of smoke for not being a very mobile weapon. It kind of feels like your feet are in the mud a lot of times when you're playing it, but that also kind of comes with experience and knowing your mobility options. As I said before, after you do an attack, you can do a side hop and you know, left or right, things like that. It's pretty nice to move around. And then also the sliding slash, you can do that by pushing circle in any direction. You can go forward, backwards, side to side. That also can open up a lot. That's a little bit riskier to do now because monsters are so fast, and you mainly just want to do that just to move around on like a downed monster. Let's say you're at its back legs, hit the back leg and then slide up to the front so you don't have to run and roll over and over and over again. And you can combine these two techniques by doing a side hop into a roll into a slide to really cover a lot of distance. Something that was a bit more useful in base world than it is now, just because the implementation of the slinger kind of zooms in a little bit. But you can do L2 and R2 and then side hop infinitely as long as you have stamina. Now, the slinger implementation kind of makes your character zoom in a little bit, but this still kind of has its uses from time to time. I don't really see myself using it all the time, but just know that it's there. What's cool about sliding as well is that it counts as like one hit. So let's say for you doing a super amped elemental discharge, you typically have to do 3 button presses, but the sliding slash counts as one hit of that as well. So you do like a slide and that's 1 and then 2 and then 3. So that's kind of nice whenever you're trying to time a super amped elemental discharge for whenever the monster's standing up. Let's say you're just kind of like smacking the monster as it's down on the ground. Then you slide back, time your shield pump. You can even kind of delay it super long and then do an amped or a super amped right as they're standing up so that you could possibly knock them back down with the super or an AED. Okay, so now you know all the mechanics of loading files and shield and sword and savage axe and some of your mobility options and how to guard point and what to look for. What's your mindset as a player? How do you get into this gameplay loop of transitioning from offense to defense and things like that? Now, I'd say probably 90% of the time that I'm playing Charge Blade, I am running around in sword and shield mode. So you're kind of running around, you're blocking, you're rolling, you're getting your guard points, you're doing your side hops into slashes and things like that. And then once you are patient enough and you see a big enough opening from the monster, you can go ahead and start to do your guard point into super amped elemental discharge or your amped elemental discharge, and then get those knockdowns on the monster. And then once the monster's knocked down, then it's your time to party. This is where Charge Blade really shines. You can start throwing your super amped elemental discharges for a bunch of damage, switch back over to sword and shield mode, start building files back up, do your attacks, load those files, go into Savage Axe, start your circle combos. This is where you're really, really dangerous as a Charge Blade player, and you kind of really need to maximize as much of this damage as possible, because you running around in neutral, you're not really doing too much damage. So just be a little bit greedy when the monster's down. And then your mindsets for guard pointing. I see a lot of kind of newer Charge Blade players rolling around a lot and trying to get away from mechanics and trying to dodge monster moves and things like that, and that's not really your mindset that you need to have with Charge Blade. It's kind of similar to like being like a lance or a gun lance player. Like, you need to be in there, you need to stand at the monster's head, you need to be brave, and you need to go through the monster instead of going around the monster. You're not playing hammer, you're not playing longsword and things like that, you're playing Charge Blade. So plant yourself, basically for most of the time you want to plant yourself at the monster's head and then just be brave and get your practice on your guard points off. Now, guard pointing is tough, and it is kind of, you know, weird timings, and it's different for monster, for every monster move and things like that, but you're not going to learn it properly, and you're not going to really, you know, blossom as a Charge Blade player unless you learn how to do these. So just be brave. You might have to take a couple steps back before you take a couple steps forward. You might cart, you might do this or that, you might catch on fire or something like that. It's all okay. It's all part of learning, and it's all part of getting better. So just get in there, plant your feet, guard point, and then start throwing your SAEDs and AEDs. Greed it out a little bit. See what you can get away with. It's just a game. If you fail it, let's say you cart 5 times, who cares? Just plant, you know, just post another quest. Who cares? Just a game. Go out there and have fun, and then be strong. Be strong, Charge Blade player. And now the question that I get asked the most all the time is, Cups, when do I Savage Axe versus SAED? And I kind of want to just say, whenever you feel like it. Now, most of the time, I would say that you want to do Savage Axe just because it's a little bit safer. It's a little bit less committal. You can crank out a lot of damage way faster because, it's like I said, it's kind of like a dual blades where you're doing a bunch of numbers really quickly. SAED is pretty risky, and a lot of the hit zone values or where the monsters take damage have been nerfed pretty hard in Iceborne. So I'd say that you basically just want to use Savage Axe on a gigantic glaring weak point of the monster. Or if the monster is really, really small, obviously you don't want to use SAED against like an Odogron because they're really small and most of your files are going to miss, or like a Kirin Kieran or something like that. Kieran is a good example of a Savage Axe matchup, just because you have Savage Axe activation and you're doing a lot of AEDs to just hit the horn, and then whenever the monster's down, you're down there and you're swinging up at the head and everything like that. Teostra is also a good example. He's got a big head that takes a bunch of damage, so put on that Ice Charge Blade and start Savage Axing his head. Now, some matchups that you want to just specifically use SAED against, Diablos or maybe like a Nargacuga, something that takes a lot of elemental damage across the entire body. So, I mean, my files against Diablos, if they're hitting the wings, are seriously doing like 400 damage per file. Some of those big body parts that take a lot of elemental damage, like Nargacuga, my files hit for like 275, 300 damage across his entire body. So those are perfect examples of Savage Axe matchups. But this is kind of just going to be, I mean, both are very viable and both are very strong. We're talking about kind of minuscule amounts of damage, and most people aren't speedrunners anyway. So I just say, just get used to seeing what openings you can do with SAED and which ones you want to do for Savage Axe, and just go out there and have fun. There's no real clear answer. It's just do whatever you want to do, basically. There are some matchups that favor, you know, Savage Axe or SAED, and I think what I'll do is in the description below, I'll go ahead and link a buddy of mine's website that he has a good little discussion about when to Savage Axe versus SAED. So make sure you go take a look at that. Okay, so now you know all the combo routes and all the major mechanics of charge blade and things like that. What do I look for whenever I'm building my sets? Let's talk about that next. When it comes to set building, I'm not really going to give you too many just direct sets, just because I want this guide to kind of last for a little bit, and everything is kind of just determined by what decorations you have, what pieces of gear you have, what your skill level is, and things like that. So I thought, instead of giving you my exact skills just for copy pasting that could be out of date within like a month or something like that, I thought I would more just give you some sort of recommended skills to use and what decorations to look forward to put into your charge blade. Now, the number one skill I'm going to recommend for charge blade players is focus. Now, focus is a skill that's going to make you build your file charge a lot faster. It's going to give your charge double slash a lot more speed. It's going to give you your sword charge, the condensed elemental slash, I think that's what it's called. It's going to give that a little bit more speed, and it's just going to make you build more files just kind of in your natural gameplay flow. So more files typically means more damage. So unless you're running a very specific sort of speedrun set where you don't need focus for a Savage Axe set or something like that, I guess you don't need to use focus for that, but I'd say probably 90% of the time I'm still going to recommend that you use focus. Another big one that you pretty much should have on every single charge blade set is capacity boost. Now, this moves you up from 5 files to 6 files. So with capacity boost, each file that you put into your shield charge is going to give you 30 seconds extra charge. Each level of file is going to give your shield charge an additional 30 seconds. So at its base, charge blade shield lasts for 2 minutes and 35 seconds, and capacity boost is going to bump that up to 3 minutes. So that's also really nice and should be put into all your charge blade sets. More files to throw, bigger SAEDs, things like that. Very, very nice. Now, when it comes to artillery or elemental, you should be using artillery only on impact file type damage. Elemental doesn't work on artillery, and artillery doesn't work on elemental. So if you're running an elemental charge blade, you don't need to run artillery. Just put more elemental damage in, ice or fire or whatever current charge blade that you're running. As I mentioned before, with guard 1 through guard 5, just kind of cater that more to your, like, your gameplay style. If you're not very good at guard pointing, then just run guard 5 pretty much against all monsters at all time. But if you're pretty advanced and you want to squeeze out as much damage as you can, go ahead and run guard 1, get your shield charge, and then try to guard point as often as you can. But like I said before, guard 1 is good for about 75% of the monsters in the game, guard 3 is good for about 90%, and then guard 5 is good for every monster in the game. Offensive guard, for some reason I see people not running offensive guard on their sets, and I think that's kind of a big mistake. At the varying levels, you get 5, 10, and 15% extra raw damage on top of your weapon, so I think that this is kind of a must-have skill, the impact file charge, because it's going to make your sword attacks do more damage, your Savage Axe do more damage, your Super Anti-Elemental Discharge do more damage, and also the files themselves are going to get the damage buff. So you pretty much should always be running offensive guard on impact files, and I see people not running offensive guard on their elemental file sets, which I don't really understand, because you are still doing a lot of sword hits and you are still doing a lot of Savage Axe and AEDs and things like that. This isn't an absolutely must-have skill, but if you're really trying to squeeze out a lot of damage, then offensive guard really can't be missed. I think it's a very nice skill. From base world to Iceborne, SAED file motion values got nerfed by 18%, so offensive guard's 15% was kind of there to offset that difference. So if you're not running offensive guard, then you're just taking an 18% damage hit for no real reason. Charge blade is one of the weapons in the game that it's just like this, and I believe greatsword, you're losing sharpness on offense and defense. So whenever you block or whenever you guard point, you're losing sharpness. So you want to make sure that you have some sort of sharpness maintenance on your weapon, so some sort of like protective polish or master's touch by using three pieces of Teostra gear, or maybe the razor sharp charm or something like that. You just want some sort of sharpness maintenance, otherwise you're going to be hitting white sharpness and then blue sharpness and then green sharpness, and then your numbers are really going to start to drop and your files will actually start to dip in damage once you hit yellow sharpness. So you just basically never want to hit that, and the lower sharpness you go, you're going to start dinking monsters and stuff like that as well. So make sure that you have some sort of sharpness maintenance on your weapon. Weakness exploit is 50% extra crit to tenderized weak points, and I think not a lot of people know how tenderizing works either. It is a heavy weapon, so it only tenderizes in one hit, and you should be focusing those weak points anyway, just because you're going to get more crit and more damage out of them, and after you tenderize, you're going to get an additional 10% damage. So if you're not tenderizing, you're pretty much just leaving 10% damage on the table. And then weakness exploit is also so easy to get. It's in so many sets, and it's only a level 2 decoration. It's very easy to get, and I recommend that you put weakness exploit and the next skill, crit boost, into pretty much everything. Crit boost is 5, 10, and 15% extra damage on top of your crits. And since, you know, most of the sets in the game are going to be running 75 to 100, sometimes over 100, maybe like 120% crit, since you're critting all the time, you basically want to run crit boost on all your sets as well. Charge Blade is notoriously very, very hungry for decorations, so just kind of get used to seeing all these recommended in pretty much every set. Crit Eye is also very nice. Crit Eye got a pretty substantial boost in Iceborne, because the last level of Crit Eye is going to give you additional 10% crit. But with some other things like Agitator and Weakness Exploit and things like that, you don't always want to cap this. The Saffy sets kind of give you passive crit levels, so you don't always need to run Weakness Exploit if you're just running some sort of comfy multiplayer set or something like that. And if you just want to throw SAEDs and not really have to worry about it, you get your affinity up to 100% without running Weakness Exploit. So if you want to do that, then maxing out Crit Eye is also really recommended. And then lastly, Agitator, and more namely Agitator Secret, that comes with two-piece Raging Bracky, because that's going to give you extra damage whenever the monster's agitated. And since we're in Master Rank, the monster's pretty much going to be agitated all the time. And then also 20% crit on top of that. So what I like to do on most of my sets is get it down to like 30% crit, and then tenderize the monster so that I'm getting 80% crit on weak points, and then agitate the monster as well. It's going to give me an additional 20%, so I'm sitting at like 100% crit on tenderized weak points. Some traps I see when it comes to charge blade set building is attack boost. I see a lot of people running attack boost 7 and things like that, and I think that's kind of like a relic from base world. Attack boost is always nice, especially attack boost level 4, because it gives you 5% affinity, but it's a bit of a trap, and your file damage isn't as affected by attack that as it used to be in base world. So, I mean, if you want to put some attack damage on, it's going to be one of your last things that you do. And if you're doing Savage Axe, then a lot of times you're not really running artillery on Savage Axe, so you can replace artillery with attack boost just to get a little bit extra damage out of it. Main reason you don't really want to run artillery on Savage Axe setups is because your file damage, so artillery and artillery secret is going to give you 10 through 50% extra damage, but your files are only hitting for like 25 damage, so 50% of 25 isn't as much as 160. So you don't really need to run artillery in a lot of Savage Axe sets. Just make sure you're putting more sharpness in and more attack boost in that regard. A couple traps when it comes to charge blade are power prolonger. Sometimes I see people doing power prolonger. It is nice to have your shield charge and your sword charge last longer, because sword charge lasts for 45 seconds and then shield charge lasts for 3 minutes. So it can make that boost a little bit longer, but charge blade is just so hungry for skills that you can't really fit power prolonger in. If you're a bit of an inexperienced player, or maybe you're doing some SOSing, or you're, you know, struggling against a certain monster or something like that, definitely feel free to put some survivability skills in, like health boost or divine blessing, something like that. A couple of those points can go a really long way. And if you're, you know, if you're out there SOSing and you don't want to throw a hunt for some strangers, definitely go in with some health boost and some of these more difficult monsters, something like a Saffy Jiva or like an AT Nami or something like that hits really, really hard and can potentially one shot you or two shot you. You might want to run some health boost on that as well. A little known thing about Charge Blade, this isn't really a recommended like armor skill, but this is a really good food skill. Feline Bombardier and Feline Booster are some two things that you should be really looking forward to. Bombardier is going to give your impact files 10% extra damage, and then Booster is going to give you, I think it's 10 raw for 10 minutes, something like that, so it's a lot of extra raw damage. Eat for Booster if you can find it, and then also, you know, do a couple meals of Bombardier built into them. Ultimately, though, it's all going to come down to your ability and your playstyle. One of the big draws a monster hunter is the ability to express yourself through your gameplay and also your set building. So if there's something that you're having fun doing and there's a certain way that you like to play, if you're, you know, if you're putting quick sheath on your charge blade, or if you're putting some divine blessing secret or something like that, ultimately just try things out and see which ones you like. These are kind of just the recommended skills that I like to use on a lot of my charge blades, and that you see kind of, you know, ubiquitous through a lot of other charge blade players, and, you know, high level and, you know, mid level and low level players like to use a lot of these skills. So just kind of look for these whenever you're building sets. Most of the time you'll see something like three-piece Teo with Damascus chest, like Bracky legs, or four-piece Bracky with Damascus chest for artillery secret. Just try things out and see which ones you like. A couple charge blades that you should be looking out for are the QR ice charge blade. Fantastic elemental weapon. All the QR charge blades are amazing on charge blade. And I'll go ahead and put in the cards now my breakdown of some of the QR charge blades and which ones you should be looking for. And then when it comes to impact file charge blade at this time of making the video, Raging Bracky has a fantastic impact charge blade, as well as Safi Jiva. Safi Jiva is going to outperform Raging Bracky by a little bit, only if you're just stacking nothing but attack into the awakenings. But keep an eye out on those and just play the game that you the way you want, and don't let people shame you unless you're, you know, obviously don't go out there and start trolling your allies by launching them into the air and stuff like that, but play how you want and build how you want. Also, a couple things to keep an eye out for, and I'll put these in the description below, is a buddy of ours, Tom, has a website where he goes through, where he constantly updates the meta sets for charge blade, the ones that have the highest damage, and different circumstantial charge blades, like when to use certain elements and things like that. So we'll go ahead and put that on there, and he's really good about updating it, so he'll, you know, be able to help you out with a lot of specific set buildings there. And then also our friend Honey Hunter, with their what, it's just Honey, but their website, Honey Hunter World, fantastic thing for making your own sets, and it'll also break down the mathematics behind them of how much effective raw you're getting, how much sharpness, how much crit, playing around with the decorations that you might have or that you might not have. It's just a fantastic tool for people to use, and you can also find some of my information on there about the sets that I use and some of the videos I've uploaded and things like that. So those are the skills that you want to look for whenever you're building your set. Okay, so now that you know that there is everything to know about the charge blade, go out there and start having some fun, throw some SAEDs around, start savage axing monsters down and things like that, and go share some information with the people that you play with. But if you guys want anything else from me, make sure you put in the comments below what your favorite thing about charge blade is, some set recommendations and stuff like that, what's working for you right now, some maybe changes that you'd like to see to charge blade in the next game. But if you guys want to see anything else from me, I stream on Twitch at twitch.tv/cups pretty much daily, and we also have my Twitter account, we have a Discord, we have a subreddit. Be a part of the community and talk to some more people about this great game and this great weapon. But I appreciate you all watching. Have a wonderful day and keep hunting.